We want to turn our attention to some of the wild swings in the stock market for particular stocks, but so much more than just that. To do that, we bring into the discussion Julia LaRoche, our correspondent, as well as a special guest, Jeff Sherman, who is the deputy CIO at DoubleLine. Julia, I'm going to throw it over to you.
Thanks so much, Adam. And Jeff Sherman, always great to have you on, and especially coming off the heels of the FOMC. So I do want to start with the Fed and your reaction to Jay Powell's presser. What stood out to you, and how is that kind of shaping how you're thinking about the markets ahead in 2021?
Yeah, well, I think that what Jay Powell did today was he confirmed what he's been doing for the last 6 months or so. And that's just saying that they're going to continue to be accommodative. They're not thinking about raising interest rates. They're continuing to have bond purchases. They're going to be supportive of the market. And thus far, they don't see some of the optimism that's been priced in some of the markets. And therefore, what I gleaned from that was him saying that they would change the path of policy if needed. And they talked about committing to having a lower interest rate for even a longer period of time. And they also said, or he also said, that they would commit to changing their asset purchase. In fact, he was signaling increasing them in that side. So I think what you're getting from the Fed is they will continue to remain accommodative. However, at the end of it, I do believe that, you know, he's saying that the handoff here is to the fiscal authorities. And, you know, when he was questioned about asset price movements and things, he was saying it's due to optimism about the vaccinations and it's the path of fiscal policy as well. So I think right now what Jay is trying to do, playing a backseat right now, but says, if you need more to keep the economy going, not markets going, but the economy going, that they're going to stand by ready to act.
Mm-hmm. And Jeff, so again, I've been meaning to ask you this because I keep having this conversation with so many different fund managers about the money supply, but also their concerns about inflation. What are your views as relates to that?
Yeah, I mean, your previous guest, Michael Cox, I think kind of nailed it, that just imagine where you'd be without the money growth and what got pumped into the system at that 26% M2 growth rate. But what's missing from the equation in the whole pricing equation is what we call money velocity. And not to sound like an economist here, but really what that's saying is, does the money go into the system and turn over? And so what you haven't seen is that commensurate velocity. And so you can't look in the vacuum alone just at money supply. However, the fundamentals are set up because if some of this asset price or wealth effect gets unleashed, and I'm not just talking about the stock market, think about the housing market. We saw the housing data come in this week. I mean, the Case-Shiller index was a mid 9% year-over-year growth rate. So think about how many people in the U.S. own homes versus own stocks. And so there is this wealth effect that's being created. And why I point that out is that if people want to tap into that, we're seeing increases in home equity lines of credit once again, and people doing cash out refinancing. And so that is something that can lead to higher inflation. Our expectations, given what we see in core inflation and what everybody refers to as base effects, is that we're likely to see around the May print in inflation a number of roughly 3% in CPI, assuming that oil prices don't really change from here. And so that'll be what we call transitory, just because of the fact that we're coming off the market lows from last year in inflation. So as we look at it, it's set up to really print around a 2% inflation rate next year, but there definitely is the potential for upside surprises. You see that in the pricing of the break-even market, how people price inflation through the treasury market. And so what we're seeing is that the fair price is out there for around 2% or so on inflation. Yep. But we have to see if we're going to get velocity and actually start to see it drive prices upward before we get nervous about inflation at this point in time.
I'm going to get myopic here and just zero in on something. It's the headline of the week, right? GameStop. And I heard someone describe this as the democratization of the markets, that for years and years, the big money was able to short and control. And now you've got bunches and bunches of retail investors who have computer power in which they can write their own algorithms to do something like what we see with GameStop. What do you think is going on here?
Yeah, I don't know if it's a democratization or it's really just cornering markets. So when you have a bunch of people, I mean, it's collusive behavior at the end of it. So is there a fundamental reason for GameStop to be where it is? I don't know. I don't think so. Our equity analysts say fair value is significantly lower than here, maybe, you know, 1/20th or 1/30th of the value of this. So is it a revolt and a democratization? I don't really think so. I think it's a bunch of people being clever and cute And at some point, there's going to be market for, there's going to be something that market forces will change this. You can't just continue to corner stocks that are being shorted by the big names and things out there. There will be some action from regulators at some point. That said, it's not going to happen this week, but you're seeing it. You're seeing these most shorted baskets be all the rage. I mean, they're up, if you take what I think it's one of the investment banks puts out there, if you look at their most shorted basket by the hedge funds using their 13F filings, what you find is that that basket's up over 400% off the market lows. And so this has been a trend. And what it is, it's one of those things where the trend is your friend until the bend at the end, right? As people say in the old adage. And so this will work until it doesn't. And just what happens with these people when all of a sudden they buy these stocks and then the reversal happens and they lose the equity capital. So it's one thing to build up the equity capital and roll it, and this process works, but it works until it doesn't. And so I'm not convinced it's a trend. It does feel like a bubble-ish type of behavior. And that's what is on the talk of everybody on Wall Street today.
Hey, Jeff and Shauna, what, I guess when you're equating this just to the broader market, what's the risk then that this potentially poses to the broader market, if any?
Well, I don't know if it's a broader market risk, but what it does is it signalizes bubblish behavior. It signalizes, you know, these blow-off tops that people write about, that they talk about euphoria. And if you notice that the darling childs of last week, like the Bitcoins and the like that everybody loved, all of a sudden are down. And so what it is that it's this concentrated fervor that's going into single names. And so I don't think it has ramifications for the broad market. But this is exactly what we talk about. We talk about blow off tops in market, euphoria. This is simple. You look at a broad market down and these same stocks that are being cornered in these chat rooms are the ones that are just doing 2 and 3x multiples in a given day. So it's not healthy for a market. It's not healthy for capitalism. I'll give AMC kudos. I was talking to my high yield portfolio manager today, and he's telling me that they issued $300 million worth of stock. And we said, oh, well, that's great, but they probably are kicking themselves. They should have waited a couple more days. But it is, you know, from that advantage that at least CFOs, if you have the ability to issue shares, you should take advantage of it and issue into the market. What that means is that there's dilutive effects, and ultimately it'll bring these prices back down. So these people that are trying to flip this stuff better get in, better get out. But it's not something of a healthy or robust market.
Jeff, you have such great insights here. And it kind of reminds me, going back to a conversation, I think the first time we met, we were talking about just Cape Shiller, the PE ratio there. And when you look at Cape today, what is that kind of telling you about the levels we're seeing in the market and what that might mean from an investing perspective?
Yeah, if you look at the Cape ratio today at the broad market, you're printing something around 33 or so. Again, just haven't looked at it in the last couple of days given price movements, but call it a 33 Cape ratio. What that implies is a forward-looking real return of around 3% or so. So 3% real, that means you add inflation back. Maybe it's a 5% kind of total return on an annualized basis for the next 10 years. But what a Cape ratio doesn't tell you is what next year's return is going to be. It doesn't tell you where froth is or anything in the marketplace. What it says is that this is what people are willing to do for earnings. And so as you take a look at that ratio, what it implies is just lower forward-looking returns. So I draw the analog to the bond market, Julia. Look at the 10-year treasury. The 10-year treasury today yields 1. So what is the expectation for the 10-year return for treasuries? It's 1, right? So if you buy it today and you hold it to maturity, that's what you'll get. So when people talk about valuation, they like to compare it to interest rates as well. But forward-looking returns are going to be lower from this starting level. Valuation matters, and that's what the Cape ratio tells you. So the idea behind it is to look at things that do have lower fundamental valuation, because that means they have higher expected returns over the long term. It doesn't tell you that you know, you're going to have this effect that you see this week. It doesn't tell you what it's going to do over the next month or so. But as a long-term investor, that's what you're trying to do.
Jeff Sherman, Double Lines Deputy CIO. Thank you. And Julia LaRoche, always good to have you both here.